You look out and find yourself the head of a nation, and due to some perceived slight or thirst for vengeance for one reason or another, you have one goal: to destroy your nation's economy. You've done what you needed to do, and your word is law, and you'll do whatever it takes to accomplish your goal. Of course, economies are resilient things, difficult to collapse even in a vacuum. As you take stock of the economy, you must first answer what makes an economy run. Well, money in combination with goods and services. Your economy produces stuff that people in other parts of the world or other parts of the nation want, and at the point of wanting this stuff and having the money to buy it, so the transactions go. Producing things for an economy requires but three fundamental components: technology, labor, and capital. Through this simple equation, your journey to destroy the economy begins. Your people produce a lot of stuff, but of course they can't do it alone. They require some money and investment from outside your borders. After all, the economy is globalized, and your people are specialized in their skill sets. The first order of business, therefore, is to close the borders. Closed now to both trade and the movement of people, your economy takes a decent hit, as people and businesses struggle to adjust to the new demands or lack thereof of the economy. But trade and the movement of people across borders are but a small portion of the economy at large. Sure, your economy is now in a very deep recession, but the overwhelming portion of your economy isn't based on imports, exports, foreign investment, or the movement of people across borders. And while your economy suffers in the short term, this is, at the end of the day, recoverable. Of course, now that people can no longer immigrate to or externally invest in your nation, your economy is going to suffer in the long run, as your economy is now permanently bound by its own internal resource and talent pool. But your impatience and waiting 100 years for the economy to collapse is untenable. And so, you have much work left to do. Foreign investment is an important piece of the pie, but it's really domestic investment that makes the biggest difference. And the next and most easy step in order to address this domestic investment problem is to immediately end all discretionary government spending. Of course, you're gonna need at least some bureaucrats and soldiers to manage the state, and most importantly, to protect you from the upcoming riots. But your word is law, and by the stroke of a pen, the government's investment in the economy and the people has ended. Under the guise of a balanced budget, cutting wasteful government spending, or whatever reason you feel the people need to hear, the state has been downsized considerably. And so, all the investments in human capital, like welfare, public transit, food aid, healthcare, and education, evaporate, along with investment in other things like roads, bridges, electrical infrastructure, etc. Private charity and industry will fill part of this now gaping hole, but you know they simply cannot compete with the breadth and depth of the need like a national government can. People riot in the streets, but that doesn't matter. You've retained the only people that matter to you in the government, the people with guns, and as long as they're fed and sheltered, you're free to continue your mission. You now turn your attention to those pesky private investors. At first, the changes don't seem so bad from their perspective. Without foreign competition, their prices went up, and without the state to provide basic services, people are more desperate than ever for any job you'll provide at any pay. And since the state no longer collects nearly as much in taxes, the government can't fund those burdensome regulatory agencies that always gave private enterprises trouble. Simply put, revenues are up and costs are down. Of course, at this point, they are none the wiser to your plan. So how can we stop private investors from spending their money into the economy? Well, it's easy. Simply take their stuff. You still have the guns on your side, and in your nation, your word is law. This seems rather contradictory to your original move of greatly downsizing the government's involvement in the economy. But remember, the goal isn't principle or consistency, it's economic collapse. You ended all government programs in order to distort the market and create a more desperate populace, and thus a less stable economy. but you kept the most important pieces of the government on the payroll, important for your next step, which is going to require a lot of guns and metal. From mining companies to banks to farms, your program of expropriation begins. The thing is, nationalizations have happened in other nations, but you're not compensating anyone for their property. Why would you? The goal isn't good governance or to align the motivations of private industry and society's needs. Your goal is economic destruction. The state bureaucracy skyrockets, but that's okay. Bureaucratic bloat only helps your cause. At this point, foreign and private investment is all but gone. Your government can extract as much rent from its people as it wants, and the economy is nothing but a tool for your personal desire. People are forced to live meager lives, and if they are lucky, they can get a job with the state. Speaking of states, in a stated society, this is as low as it gets economically speaking. Your people are hungry from the lack of efficient food production and distribution. There is no entrepreneurial spirit or innovation because there are no entrepreneurs or innovators, and there never will be. After all, there's no need to fund a good education system in a nation that doesn't care about or need economic growth. At this point, there isn't much left for you to do. The last card in your deck is simply to abdicate. With abdication goes the last key holding the economy together. You, your direction, your seat at the throne of the economy. You've left neither instruction on what to do upon your abdication, nor a chosen or clear successor. You've been careful to distribute the small amount of power delegated to the other actors in society to such an extent that there's no clear number two, there's no clear successor. The rest of the guns are split up fairly evenly, and the remaining state actors are forced to ask themselves several questions. What's next? Who will lead? Can I be the one next in line? The remaining actors are forced to figure this out for themselves as the last step of your plan enacts itself. Chaos follows your abdication as the remaining state actors scramble for power. A hyper-fragmented civil war ensues and the state as you knew it collapses. In a world with central control, the lack of direction on your succession is the final nail in the coffin of your nation's economy. Civil war and internal conflict will ensure that even without the state enforcing custom standards, regulations, and immigration, no one and no investor will interact with your economy, and no private investment will sustain itself. Instability is your legacy, and the economy goes with it. Except until it doesn't. Eventually, outside actors or someone from within will seize control of the moment and the economy will come back to a form possibly resembling its state before you took over. Perhaps this'll take 10 years, perhaps 100, maybe several hundred, but it will happen. Economies are resilient, and the distribution of scarce resources will happen at the end of the day through one form or another, despite your legacy's lack of permanence. You've done as much as any one government or one person can do to destroy a nation's economy, and I'm not sure anyone could consider you particularly unsuccessful in that regard.